Good morning to you. Welcome to the Gerontological Society of Singapore's annual scientific conference on aging. For this year, the theme of the conference is Good News of Aging. Well, you might be thinking, amidst all the challenges and difficulties that people are experiencing and talking about aging, why is the Gerontological Society of Singapore going to talk to you about the good news of aging? So please stay tuned for the rest of the day where we have four symposiums lined up to tell you why we should stay positive about aging. For now, can we put our hands together to welcome our guest of honour, Dr. Amy Khor, Senior Minister of State for the Ministry of Health. Dr. Khor, please. May I now welcome the chairman of today's conference, Dr. Goh Lee Gan, on stage to give us the welcome address. Prof. Goh, please.
Thank you, Alice. Guest of honor, Dr. Amy Khor, Senior Minister of State, Ministry of Health, Mrs. Betty Chen, Chairperson, Chinese Women's Association, Mrs. Maria Schwab, Association of, I don't know how to pronounce this word, the French Association of Singapore, Mr. Raymond Lim and Mrs. Lim, speakers and chairpersons, distinguished guests and delegates, friends. Good morning. On behalf of the President and Council of the Gerontological Society, let me bid you a warm welcome to the 2016 Annual Scientific Conference on Aging. Thank you, Dr. Amy Khor, for gracing the occasion as the guest of honor. We're indeed very happy of your support that you've given to us all these years. Well, this year's conference is a little special because this is the 30th anniversary conference. Now, way back 30 years ago, the late Mr. Henry Lim and a band of like-minded men and women got together to form the Gerontological Society of Singapore, and their vision for the society then and for the society at large was to change the mindset of young and old. They were the forerunners of what is the Singapore's Celebrate Aging vision. I think it's very important that we take on that vision that aging is indeed something to be celebrated instead of being avoided. Certainly it's not doom and gloom. And quite opposite to what Shakespeare says in As You Like It, which I like to quote this phrase. He says that the last of the seven ages of men, and of course that includes women, as second childishness and mere oblivion, sense eyes, cannot see, and sense taste, cannot taste, and sense everything. I think the elderly of today and tomorrow is not going to be like that, simply because we know what to do to prevent all these things from happening to us. Okay, like in previous years, the conference that we have has got five parts. That's the opening segment, and then we have four symposia, and we end up 5:30 or so. And for today, we are happy that Dr. Amy Khor is giving us the keynote address. Also, we are asking her to launch the Dementia Prevention Program as a community translational research program. More of that later. And then, of course, we must thank Mrs. Chen and the French Association of Women for giving us a check to continue the work of the Dementia Prevention Program. And we also have the 9th Henry Lim Lecture that will be given by Professor Rathi. So that will be the opening segment. Of course, this will be followed by the four symposia, And for this year, we're going to talk about the progress of the dementia prevention program in Symposium 1, followed by Symposium 2 on the inclusive environment for good aging. I think the environment is very important, and indeed, we're going to focus on that in Symposium 2. Symposium 3, we have management of dementia in the community. There will always be people who are demented. Can we help them to have a better life? I think it's important, right? And lastly, of course, how do we enhance the care of the elderly into the future? So that in a nutshell are the four symposia, and the details are in the program, which I leave you to look at. Of course, in addition to that, we have a poster display. I think it's coming, where we will select three of the best posters and give them prizes. Okay, so with that, I finally come to the end of my presentation, the welcome, and I'd like to thank several groups of people in this room. First, of course, is the delegates of this conference. Without you folks, there will be nobody to talk to. I must really thank you for sort of signing up and coming this morning. Of course, we need to thank the speakers and chairpersons, and we must also thank Jenny Lee and her team for organizing this conference and getting things ready. Indeed, there's a lot of work that they have done. And then, of course, there's a host organizing committee, my team of people, and of course, the GSS Council, and many others, too many to mention my name, who have helped in one way or the other. Let us give ourselves a big hand, shall we? Yeah. Thank you very much for all your help. And finally, let me wish everyone a fruitful day in this conference, in the experience of learning, sharing, exchanging facts, views, and opinions on the good news of aging. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Goh. I would like to invite our guest of honour, Dr. Amy Khor, on stage to deliver the keynote address. Dr. Khor, please.
Mr. Lawrence Wee, President of the Gerontological Society of Singapore, Associate Professor Goh Lee Gan, Chairman of the Organising Committee for the Annual Scientific Conference on Ageing, ASCA 2016, Mr. Raymond Lim, my dear ex-colleague, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, a very good morning to one and all. I'm indeed impressed that this hall is actually filled up so early in the morning. I'm delighted to join you at this year's annual scientific conference on aging, organized by the Gerontological Society. I'm happy to note that this event is held in conjunction with the Society's 30th anniversary celebration. So let me take this opportunity to congratulate the Society on this very significant milestone. And in fact, I think, you know, the founders have been really far-sighted. So please give yourself a big round of applause. Singapore is, as all of us know, rapidly aging. By 2030, about one in four Singaporeans will be aged 65 and above. But our population is aging partly because we are living longer. And not only are we living longer, we are also living longer in good health. So that's the good news. Between 1990 and 2013, our life expectancy increased by 7.1 years. More importantly, our healthy life expectancy also improved by 5.5 years for males and 4.9 years for females over the same period. So that's the good news. Except that for the women, I think we have to tell you, work a bit harder, especially when we live longer. Therefore, instead of worrying about getting older, we should embrace opportunities arising from our longer life years. I'm therefore encouraged to note that the theme for today's conference is good news of aging. It is a powerful theme that seeks to shift our mental frame and narrative about aging from one that is associated with illnesses and disabilities to one that is filled with opportunities. Indeed, it is with an aspiration to help Singaporeans maximize their opportunities from longevity that the Ministerial Committee on Aging launched the full report of the Action Plan for Successful Aging in February this year. This action plan covers more than 70 initiatives across 12 areas, and it maps out a blueprint for a whole-of-society approach to prepare for a rapidly aging Singapore. These 12 areas range from health and wellness, learning, volunteerism, employment, housing, transport, public spaces, respect and social inclusion, retirement adequacy, healthcare and aged care, protection for vulnerable seniors, to research. And I must say that this action plan is a living document. It will remain a work in progress because we will welcome and support good initiatives which are significant, sustainable, and scalable. This action plan seeks to help Singaporeans stay healthy, engaged, and productive, and age with grace and confidence. It also aims to build a cohesive society where there is intergenerational harmony and transform Singapore into an enabling city that can support Singaporeans to age gracefully in place. When we held the public consultation for the development of the action plan, many Singaporeans told us that they would like to continue to learn and contribute to the community, even in their silver years. As such, we launched a National Silver Academy and a National Senior Volunteerism Movement under the Action Plan, so that seniors can look forward to these opportunities and experience for themselves the good news of aging. Indeed, the National Silver Academy website was just launched yesterday and it's gone on live. You can actually go in and register for some of the courses. As a start, the new National Silver Academy, or NSA, will offer seniors more than 10,000 learning places across more than 500 courses this year. Seniors will receive up to 50% subsidy for short courses offered by our post-secondary educational institutions, including the universities and the polytechnics and ITEs, and may also choose to attend selected modules from existing degree or diploma programs without having to take the exams and only for a token fee. So they can actually attend these classes together with the other students, who are much younger and feel young again. Seniors can also tap on their SkillsFuture credit to cover the balance of the course fees payable after government subsidy for a vast majority of the NSA courses, making them even more affordable. In fact, as of last count, I'm told that more than 70% of the courses are SkillsFuture credit eligible. Through the National Silver Academy, seniors can enjoy a diverse selection of courses ranging from wine appreciation and tasting workshop by the Institute of Technical Education, psychology of aging by Temasek Polytechnic, to introduction to interior design by the Nanyang Academy of Fine Arts, or NAFA. In fact, looking at these courses, I too, is attracted to take up some of these courses. And I also qualify. Apart from the National Silver Academy, we will also like to encourage more seniors to volunteer their time and contribute to community development in a variety of ways, such as befriending vulnerable seniors in the community, participating in community gardening, or participating in reading programs for school children. We target to recruit an additional 50,000 senior volunteers by 2030, and have set up a silver volunteer fund with a target size of $40 million to help our community organizations better recruit and develop these senior volunteers. Seniors also recognize that health is wealth, as they need to remain healthy in order to enjoy other aspects of life. Hence, another key initiative under the action plan is the launch of a new National Seniors Health Program. This program is aimed at empowering our seniors to stay healthy and adopt healthy living habits by bringing healthy aging programs closer to our seniors and in a structured and more systematic manner. Through this program, we want to educate our seniors on key preventive health issues which are important as we grow older, such as nutrition, exercise, and mental wellness. We will also want to help our seniors understand how to minimize their risk for conditions such as stroke, falls, and dementia. Several community groups have also taken the initiative to bring preventive health programs closer to our seniors. The Dementia Prevention Program, or DPP, which we are launching later, is one such program. This is the result of a fruitful partnership between the National University Health System, or NUHS, the People's Association, and the National Parks Board. The DPP first started in 2013 as a pilot for about 100 seniors in Tara at Jurong Point. This program comprises health educational talks, Tai Chi exercise, mindfulness, art therapy, and reminiscence therapy. Preliminary results have been promising. Not only have these seniors shown a decrease in symptoms related to anxiety and depression, about 20% of the participants also showed an improvement in concentration and memory. With the initial success of the program, the DPP has now been extended to the community. Community gardening has also been added as part of the DPP. Since September 2015, the Dementia Prevention Program, which is part of PA's National Wellness Program, has now been introduced in Queenstown as well as Eunos. And after 3 months of participation, the seniors similarly showed improvements in terms of social connectedness and life satisfaction, coupled with a decrease in anxiety and depressive symptoms. The program will be further evaluated for its effectiveness in protecting our seniors against the onset of dementia, and if successful, more sites will be expected to come on board in future. This partnership is a good example of how the community can come together to introduce active aging and preventive health programs to serve our seniors better in the community. In closing, I am really encouraged to see the Gerontological Society take the lead in celebrating aging and share the good news of aging. As a society, we can initiate more ground-up initiatives and community programs to help our seniors age in place with confidence and dignity. We can all come together, and indeed we need to come together to build a nation of all ages. And done right, Singapore can become an icon for successful aging. Let me end by wishing all of you a most fruitful conference. Thank you very much.
May I invite the President of the Gerontological Society of Singapore, Mr. Lawrence Wee, to present a token of appreciation to our guest of honour, Dr. Amy Khor. Lawrence, please. Now I'd like to invite Professor Goh Lee Gan on stage to share a few words on the Dementia Prevention Program.
Okay, so we have the launch of the DPP program, and this is just a few words to introduce that. Well, the DPP, or Dementia Prevention Program, is a social experiment that we have in what we call translational research from the bench to the community. Essentially, what we wanted to do is to say, okay, we have discovered that by helping people to be active, we can reduce dementia, anxiety, and also, in the long run, reduce dementia. So we set to work on this project a year ago, and this is the end of the first year. So we actually survived the first year, and we thought it is time to therefore celebrate on that event. And so for this, we're going to ask Dr. Amy Khor to press the clicker from where she's sitting, and that will launch a program. Okay, so over to you. Okay.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Right, thank you, Dr. Khor. Yeah. More of that dementia project later on.
Thank you, Prof. Goh. Well, we've seen lots of pictures there, happy faces, you know, of people participating in the DPP. So, of course, for an important program like that, right, you need brains, right? So we have professors from the NUH and their partners. We need willing hands. So we have the community coming in, like the People's Association. We have willing hearts. But I think a lot of times, we also need people who are able to also donate generously towards programs that are so meaningful. So of course, we have our distinguished donors who have taken time off to be with us this morning. And I'd like to invite our Professor Khor, who is also one of the big men behind this dementia prevention program, on stage, where he'll present to you our generous donors. Professor Khor, please.
Thank you, Alice. The dementia prevention program, in fact, was planned about 12 years ago. I had a long discussion with Professor Goh Lee Gan, and I told him that from the rich data we had from the memory clinic in NUH, we know that the life expectancy of patients with dementia here in Singapore is a bit different from the experience in the UK. The data from UK showed that about their life expectancy about 5 to 7 years. But in the NUH data, we found it's about 10 to 12 years. And we know that if we can maintain or control the blood pressure, the hypertension, the diabetes, and also the introduced diet, the control and exercise, and also mental stimulation like art and music, we can improve the quality of life of our patients and also to extend the life expectancy. And so from those ideas, we thought there could be a program. But the program could not start because there was no funding. And in fact, we went to a funding agency, and the lady told me that, well, they haven't started in America, you know. How are you sure you can get it successful in Singapore? I'm sometimes dismayed that we still have doubts about our intellect, you know, in a way that we always look upon the people across the ocean for direction. You know, I'm very glad to say that the first person who supported us was the late Mr. Henry Lim. And after a year, the program started 3 years now. After a year, the editor of the prestigious British journal, research journal called The Lancet, wanted a report because the program is supposed to be for 10 years. But after a year, the editor heard about it and said, we must tell the world about this. We must publish it. Don't wait for 10 years. So the data came out for the first year. And one of the reasons why he was very keen to publish it, because it's a different way of doing research, that it is the community, the groundswell that came up to support it. We had a tagline for this program. The tagline is preventive medicine in the community, by the community, and for the community. So by the community, we have many people who came. to help us. Down there is Mr. Wee Sin To, who is one of the supporters, donors, K.H. Tan, Catherine Ng and the family. And also we have the Kuan Yin Temple, the Lee Kim Tao family. They gave us the donation for us to start the project. My friends from Harvard who came down to see the project, they were amazed. 10 years ago, I gave a lecture in Harvard University. They told me it's a very good project, but very difficult. You know, they say you expect about to have about $30 million to kickstart the whole project, but only had a shoestring budget about $2 million. You know, and many people came as volunteers. You know, so in the audience there are volunteers like Mr. Wong Lit Soon, art therapist, Mr. Wee is a mindfulness expert. And there are also others from NParks, people from PA. Lots of volunteers came on board to help us out, and they enjoyed it. You know. So the Lancet editor was so enthusiastic. There's something different in the research here than compared to North America or the UK. And also the research was done in a shopping mall. The first time a research center was in a shopping mall, and a family paid for the rental of the shopping mall for us. And something very innovative in research. It's not just it must be in, the research must be in a hospital, you know. And I'm very glad today that the Chinese Women's Association, Mrs. Betty Chen, the president, his colleagues have also organized some dinners and lunches, and the proceeds have come for this program. And the Chinese Women Association has been linked with our society for 30 years. When we first formed, the president of the CWA was Mrs. May Wong, Betty's mother. And she was one of the first members of our society, and she's always been very supportive. In fact, 30 years ago, she asked me, what can I do for dementia? 30 years ago, and I told her, set up a day center. And the day center is now 30 years. You know, it's called the May Wong Day Center at Henderson. And the Chinese women, you realize they play a very quiet but very important diplomatic role, you know, the soft diplomacy. They often invite all the wives of the ambassadors and the business people together and show them how Singapore whole function together and build up relationships. And I think the foreign ministry should be very glad that they are doing something wonderful for the country. A couple of months ago, they invited their French friends, Genevieve Grovier, and also Maria Schwab. They all had a gala dinner at the Shangri-La Hotel, and the proceeds will be for this program. Now I shall call upon the guest of honor, Dr. Amy Khor, to come on board together with Mrs. Betty Chen, and also Madam Genevieve Grovier. That's right. We'll get a check. We're coming up here to deliver a check. And Professor Goh will, and Mr. Wee Sin To, can we come on stage to accept on behalf of NUS? Mr. Wee Sin To is an advisor to the president, NUS president. Yeah. So thank you, Dr. Amy Khor, Mrs. Betty Chen, and Mrs. Genevieve Grovelier. I must thank Mr. Wee Sin Toh. I jump on him to come up to represent the president. Yeah. Before I introduce the speaker, let me say a few words about the Henry Lim lecture. Some 30 years ago, Dr. Anne Merriman, who was then the NUS geriatrician, discussed with me the possibility of forming a society for geriatric medicine, for geriatric society. But I told her that there were only four people interested in geriatric medicine, and I told him that we should have, told her that we should have a gerontological society, so it's open to nurses, social workers, anyone interested in aging. And so the society was formed sometime in May of 1986. And I told Dr. Anne Merriman that there's somebody who was always writing letters to the forums section of the Straits Times, all highlighting the needs of the elderly, the plight of the elderly. And that person was the late Mr. Henry Lim. We managed to track him down and ask him to join the first council, and Mr. Henry Lim became the treasurer and subsequently became the president of the society. And during his tenure, he did many things. That's why we want to honor him with a special lecture. And one of the things he did was, in sometime in 1995, the suicide rate for elderly Chinese men was about the second highest in the world. And so Mr. Henry Lim spoke to me. I told him that one way is public education and destigmatize depression. And that's what we did. And together with Ministry of Health, MCD, and the university, the suicide rate came down. And some of you may know that's the first time in the world that a country has brought the suicide rate down for old people. The second thing he did was to improve the aged homes in the country. And sometime in 1990, we were both asked by MCD, the present MSF, the Ministry of Community Development, to be volunteers for the Woodlands Home. And it was the biggest home that I've ever been to, 600 elderly people in a sprawling campus. You know, it is now the site of the turf club. And Mr. Henry Lim made many recommendations to MCD to improve the living condition of old people in home. The third thing he did, as I mentioned earlier, was to kickstart the dementia prevention program, something that he told us about and he mentioned to me many times. For example, for people with depression, instead of treating depression, can you go upstream to find out what happened to these people and prevent them, you know, from having depression? And so that's what the DPP was all about. You know. And we have many distinguished speakers, and the fifth speaker was Professor John Groudon, professor of medicine from Harvard, who came to deliver the Henry Lim lecture, and also Professor Edmund Chui from Melbourne University. Today we have a very special person, Professor Rathi Mahendran. Professor Mahendran was previously the medical director or the chairman medical board of Institute of Mental Health. And the last 5 years in NUS played a very big role in terms of research. And one of our research areas is psycho-oncology. And earlier on, Mrs. Catherine Ng and K.H. Tan asked me, what is a psycho-oncology? We found that many people with cancer also have depression and anxiety. If you can treat their psychological problems, it helps to lift up their immune system. People who are depressed have lower immune system. And something she's doing, not only for the patient, but also caregivers, and also for the health caregivers. The nurses, the doctors also go through a lot of stress caring for people with cancer. This is the one major area she's involved in, and also sometime in November, she's holding a big conference in Singapore on this issue. Her input into the dementia program is something very, very important, not only for Singapore, but the world. And together with her team, also with the work by Mr. Wee Sin Toh, they started a big project on mindfulness meditation practice for the mental health of old people. Use very sophisticated brain imaging study, and it's the first study in the world on that, and she could present to you some of the data. And next month, she'll also be the principal investigator of an interesting study on art therapy the music, you know, to whether it can help also in the mental health of elder people. So all these activities are non-drug approach. Something we have in the community, beautiful gardens, art and music and all that, can something be done? You know, so old people, if they can get involved with this, can it promote their mental health and prevent dementia and depression? These are searching research questions that we want to ask. Last week, she was honored by the Psychiatrist Association for the award, for the Distinguished Psychiatrist Award. And despite all these accolades, she remains charmingly modest and remarkably humble. You know. So to deliver the 9th Henry Lim Lecture, shall we welcome Professor Rathi Mahendran.
I'd like to first thank the President of the Gerontological Society, as well as the Chairman of the Organizing Committee for inviting me to deliver this lecture. It's indeed an honor to deliver the Henry Lim Lecture this morning. As you can imagine, for clinician researchers, if they don't have their computer and their notes, they are rather lost. So I hope today to present to you compelling evidence that psychosocial interventions do benefit elderly individuals in terms of their physical health, their cognition, and their mental health. So not only at the individual level do we see improvements, but also at the community level, and we hope this will transform care across the country for all the elderly. It all began really with the Jurong Aging Studies, which were naturalistic studies that were done and started in 2012. Now, many people have talked about this already, and you've probably heard us present it, but I think it's important to cover what was done in the early stages. We went out into the community and offered different psychosocial interventions to the elderly who were living out there, and these included mindfulness practice, art therapy, Tai Chi exercise, music reminiscence therapy, and for everyone as well, health education talks. Now, the important part of these early studies was this. We allowed the individuals a choice of what they wanted to participate in. So in the initial period, there were 200 plus individuals who came and participated. And at that time, our focus was mainly on mood symptoms. We looked at anxiety and depression, and we wanted to study and see if we could find improvements. And that's what we did. Very quickly at week 4 and at week 10 of the intervention, and this was done weekly, we began to see improvements. Now pay attention to these bar charts. Those which have asterisks at the top of them were the activities in which we saw significant improvements. So the green bar chart for mindfulness practice, the blue bar chart for music activity, and the purple bar chart for art therapy. So not only did we see improvements at week 10, but we also continued to see those improvements at 6 months and also up to a year. Now, the importance of these studies is this. Yes, we learned that psychosocial interventions do improve mood, both anxiety and depression. But more importantly, these early studies actually paved the way for more extensive investigations and research of higher scientific rigor. And the first of this was the mindful awareness practice, which was a randomized controlled trial. So of the three activities in which we saw improvement, we started off with mindful awareness practice. And this particular study, we also had a control group to compare the effects of mindfulness practice. And for the control group, we only provided them with health education talks. The other important thing about this particular study was that we narrowed our focus, not to every elderly person living in the community, but we narrowed our focus to those who had mild cognitive impairment, or MCI. Now, what's the importance of MCI? This is considered an intermediate stage between normal aging and dementia. So our research question was this: could we do something for these individuals and move them or stop the decline at this stage so that they didn't go on to dementia? Or could we actually reverse the cognitive impairment and pull them up into normal aging? So that was the focus. And we also did extensive investigations, as Prof. Kwan mentioned. We did imaging studies of the brain because we wanted to look out and see if there were structural changes in the brain as a result of this mindfulness practice. We collected urine samples, we collected blood samples because we wanted to look out for biological markers of inflammation and stress. We wanted to study telomere lengths and chromosome changes. We also collected stool to look at gut bacteria to see if there were any changes. And importantly, we did a whole series of neuropsychological tests to look and see if there were any cognitive improvement. We did this study over a 9-month period. In the first 3 months, there were weekly intervention. And then in the subsequent 3 to 9 months, it was monthly intervention. So the first results, and this is from neuroimaging that was done. Now, I'm not going to go into details because later on this morning, Dr. Johnson Pham, who was the person who focused on this particular area and analyzed the data, he's going to give you more details. But what I'm going to do is to actually highlight two important changes that we found. Just within 12 weeks or 3 months of mindfulness practice, we could see in all those individuals who were in mindful awareness practice, firstly, higher nodal efficiency. Now, what does that mean? Basically, there were increasing areas in the brain that were lit up after 3 months of mindful awareness practice. So where areas of the brain were inactive and dormant previously at baseline, they were now becoming more active. The second thing that we found was improved network efficiency, which basically refers to increased neural transmission to different parts of the brain. So structural changes were possible with just 3 months of active mindfulness practice. The next thing that we did to look at cognition was a whole series of neuropsychological tests, and there are 5 of them listed here. And they studied various cognitive domains. We looked at changes in memory, we looked at changes in attention and concentration, we did a block design to look out for visuospatial skills changes in the elderly. And finally, we also did color trails, a test that looks out at higher executive functioning. So looking at the ability to reason, to think, to make decisions, and to make proper judgment. So these were the extensive tests that we did. And what you will see, it's a bit faint. But nonetheless, if you see under change there, you will see the results that we found at 3 months, and all of it has plus signs, which means there were positive changes and improvements. For some of those tests, there is a p-value indicating that there were significant changes that we saw at 3 months. And these were for people in mindful awareness practice as compared to the control group. Now look at the data at 9 months, and that is the last column there. Only some of the tests showed positive changes. Some of them have a dash, meaning no significant change. And we'll come to that, and I'll explain why that happened. Sorry, a bit of a hitch. But basically what I'm going to do in the next couple of slides... Next one. Okay, so what I've done is really place those results in a graph form so that it's easier to appreciate the magnitude of the changes that we saw. Now, in red lines are those individuals who were in the mindful awareness practice. In blue line were those in the control arm who were only given health education talks. Now, you can see straight away that the health education talk individuals are at a higher level than the mindful awareness practice. Now, what happened? I talked about doing a randomized control trial. In such a trial, we use a computer-generated program to randomly assign individuals in a study to two different arms of the study. But despite that, despite doing this randomization, we ended up with people in the mindful awareness group who were cognitively worse off at baseline than those who were in the control group. So despite that, you see that with the intervention, they actually showed significant improvements on their cognitive tests. So as they started off at baseline worse off, but they caught up, as you can see in the second slide, they actually shot up and did better than those in the control group. Here again, we see in digit span tasks, similar significant improvements, and also in the block design. So in all these tests, people who were in the psychosocial intervention groups did well. Now, I just want to go back to the earlier slide, and again, I want to highlight that we saw a drop in their scores between 3 months and 9 months. And you remember earlier on, I said also, when I showed it, that we saw a lot of negative results. So keep that in mind again as we move on, and I will explain why that was possible. The other thing that we studied was we looked at chromosomes and we looked at the telomeres. Now, what are telomeres? Telomeres are really base pairs of amino acids that stand at the tip of our chromosomes. And they play a very important role. They have a protective function. As you know, cells in our bodies need to continuously divide. And when they divide and reproduce, the chromosomes themselves need to replicate. These telomeres, by being present there, prevent these chromosomes from unraveling. Because if the chromosomes unravel, that leads to cell death. And of course, if you continuously have cell death in important areas such as the brain, that leads to cognitive decline. So our research question here was this. Could we, by introducing mindfulness practice, do something about this shrink in the size of the telomeres at the tips of the chromosomes? And that's exactly what we found. Again, you see at baseline, the mindful awareness people were much lower in their performance. And then with 3 months of intervention, the changes in the base pairs of the telomeres grew much more than it did in those who were in the health education program. Again, we found the decline at 3 months to 9 months, similar to the pattern that we saw with the neuropsychological test. And I'll explain a little bit. Now, in the first 3 months, we did weekly intervention. However, from 3 months to 9 months, we saw them at monthly intervals. Now, we did encourage our participants to come to practice regularly what we had taught them, and we also made them keep records of their practice sessions. Now, when we went back to review those records, what we realized was that they were not practicing as often as they should be, and this, in a way, has contributed to the decline. So if you didn't practice regularly what was taught, the mindfulness practice, then whatever achievements you had made from baseline to 3 months did not persist. Okay, so important information for us. Now, we also know that cognitive decline is related to inflammatory processes in the brain. So again, one of the questions that we wanted to find out was, with mindfulness practice, could the body then build up a defense mechanism and produce anti-inflammatory substances? So we looked out for various anti-inflammatory substances, but what we did was, and here all I'm going to do is just show you one particular substance, which is allantoin. It has both antioxidative as well as anti-inflammatory activities. And again, you can see for those people who were in the mindful awareness practice group, their levels of allantoin were significantly higher at 3 months. So for these people, their bodies were able to mount a defense to the inflammation that was occurring and do something about it. We also were keen to look at inflammation in the gut. Now, why are we looking at gut bacteria? What has that got to do with cognition? I think from studies that have already been done, we know that as we age, there are a lot of changes that happen in our body, and so the intestines also are not protected. There are changes at a physiological level. The bacteria in our gut changes as we age. There are more pathogen-type bacteria that grow. And of course, our diet also changes. Now, all these kind of changes can contribute to low-grade inflammation that continues as we grow older. Now, you may not be aware of it. It doesn't manifest as diarrhea or other problems. But this continuing low-grade inflammation contributes to increasing inflammatory substances, which again travel up to the brain, cause damage to glial cells, and lead to cognitive decline. All right. So with that in mind, we had in earlier years looked and studied at the gut bacteria profile in the elderly in the Jurong area. And what we found actually is by just studying the bacteria that was present in the gut, we could clearly distinguish those who were aging normally, and that is shown on this particular graph. All the little triangles in yellow are people who are aging normally. as compared to those in the red and blue dots, people who already have mild cognitive impairment and dementia. So just by looking at the gut bacterial profile, we could distinguish the two. So the next question was, could mindfulness practice then also bring about a change in the gut bacteria? And that's exactly what we found. We studied three big groups of gut bacteria. There are many different bacteria, but we chose these three common ones: bacteroidetes, and firmicutes, and proteobacteria. Now, bacteroidetes is common with people who eat a lot of meat. So for those of you who enjoy your steak, your chicken, and other meat, well, you're going to have high levels of bacteroidetes. For those who prefer vegetables, green leafy vegetables, grains, and so on, you have higher numbers of firmicutes. But generally, for all of us, there is a balance of both these type of bacteria. Also present in all our gut bacteria are proteobacteria. These, unfortunately, are the pathogens. I'll name some of them and you'll recognize them. Things like Salmonella, E. coli, Shigella. Now, in large amounts, they cause a lot of problems, but they are present in very minute amounts. But if they continue to exist, and as we grow older, more and more numbers climb, that's when they contribute towards the inflammation that we talked about. Now, as you can see, for proteobacteria, levels are very low. It's a bit difficult to explain these units. They're very tiny. In microbiology terms, we refer to them as OTU, operational taxonomical units, because there are hundreds and thousands of bacteria, so it's very difficult to count them. So they use this special counting measure, OTUs. So we found very low levels of proteobacteria, 0.7, but with mindfulness practice, you can see within 3 months, the levels had already dropped. So we could remove the pathogenic bacteria from ourselves. Okay, so from the mindful awareness practice, I think there are a couple of important information that we gathered. Firstly, we can bring about significant improvements in cognition and changes in biological markers. And this could be at the biochemical level, this could be at the cellular level, it can be also at the molecular level in elderly with MCI. But the important message here was that sustainability of whatever effects and gains that we get from mindfulness practice disappears without regular practice. So that's what we have to keep in mind when we roll out these programs for the elderly. I'm going to quickly also talk about another study that we did, and this was looking at health and neighborhood characteristics. And we studied three different cities, Singapore, Hong Kong, as well as Tokyo. And in this study, we looked at urban planning. We looked at the design, diversity, density of the area in which the elderly lived. We looked at network distance. For example, an individual lives in a place. What is the distance to the supermarket, to the bank, to see a doctor? So that is important for the elderly individual. So we measured network distance. We look at walkability. How safe was the environment for them to walk? Were the pavements well done? Were there pedestrian crossings? Were there overhead bridges? And then importantly also, we looked at social capital. Social capital referring to people that they were close to and related well with. So here is a chart showing the different areas that we studied. In Singapore, it was in the Jurong West area. In Hong Kong and Tokyo, those were the regions. And I just put up that little graph there to show you how complicated the analysis was. It was nothing like the simple graphs that I showed for the neuropsychological test. So I won't show you more. I will just do a quick summary. For Singapore, what we found that physical health was extremely important for the individuals that we studied. For those with high levels of uncontrolled blood pressure, for those who had severe arthritic knee pain, they were at risk of higher scores for depression. In addition, those who had high BMI, so those who were obese, who were overweight, they too were at risk not only for depression, but also higher rates of cognitive impairment. When we aggregated the data for all three cities, this is what we found. Walkable neighborhoods resulted in seniors with better physical health. And that seems intuitive. But what's more important is the next finding, that activity and lifestyle was dependent not only on a great walkable neighborhood, but also on the presence of sociable seniors. You remember we studied social capital. And that brings us very nicely, really, to the dementia prevention program that is being rolled out. So it's important to remember that having sociable seniors to encourage others who are not so active in the community is going to make a big difference. And I think Prof. Goh and his team are going to talk about this a little later. I just want to highlight two more studies, one on the effect of horticultural therapy that is being done, and Associate Professor Roger Ho is going to talk to you about it. And the next one, very well known and publicized in the newspapers, are choral singing for the prevention of dementia. And this is a two-year study that started sometime last year and led by Dr. Feng Lei. So I hope... before I go on, I finally want to mention the third of the studies that we are going to do, and this is the art and music reminiscence therapy in the prevention of cognitive decline. Here we are going to look at art, music reminiscence, and also have a control group, and also do a wide range of investigations. What's going to be important here is in this particular study, we are also going to look at societal inclusiveness. We are going to have individuals go to the NUS Museum, also go to the National Gallery, and see what effect that has on these elderly. So I have presented quite a few studies, and I hope you begin to see how effective psychosocial interventions can be. I think they are safe, they are effective, definitely without side effects, and they are something that we can easily roll out to elderly in the community. And importantly, it also gives the elderly a choice of what activities they want to participate in. So I'm going to end there, time's up. And I'd like to thank really a whole lot of people. As you can imagine, for these kind of studies, you really need huge teams, commitment, time, and effort. In particular, the people I want to particularly acknowledge, Professor Kwa Yee Hyok. He's the one who had the foresight and the planning to initiate the studies, the naturalistic studies, and then helped us drive forward the research. And both Prof. Kwa and Prof. Goh Lee Gan for the Dementia Prevention Project. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Prof. Rathi, for the keynote address. I'd like to now invite a very distinguished guest that we have here amongst our midst today. In honour of the late Mr. Henry Lim, we have his son, Mr. Raymond Lim, who is here to present a token appreciation to our keynote speaker for the 9th Henry Lim lecture to Professor Rathi. Mr. Raymond Lim, please. Right, thank you once again, Professor Rathi and Mr. Raymond Lim. It is time for our tea break. Shall we come back here in about 15 minutes' time, by 10 o'clock in the morning, please? And then we'll start our four symposiums, all relating to the theme of Good News of Aging. Thank you very much.
The Honourable Minister, Dr. Amy Khor, distinguished guests, friends and colleagues. All right. Let us recommence. All right. This particular session is will focus on the Dementia Prevention Program. And we have forgotten to inform all of you, the person who the driving force in this program is, in fact, Mrs. Teo Po Yin, who is here. like Professor Mahendran, she's also charmingly modest. So we have three speakers for this session symposium. The first speaker is Professor Goh Lee Gan, and we all know him, that we are... Two of us are in this, we are partners in crime, you see, getting this program out. And shall we welcome Professor Goh again?
Good morning once again. Thank you, Ihyok, for the introduction. Good morning, Mr. Steele, nice to see you. Well, we indeed couldn't have kickstarted this program if not for the support of many, many people from different walks of life. So I think that is the secret of translation research. How do you get the whole community to move together in tandem, like a laser pointer? Okay, so my brief is to share with you, so what have we been doing? What we have got is this project that we have 1 year's experience in translating from the bench to the community, as I said just now. Of course, the bench took several years, as Prof. Rathi has shown you. The way back in 2010, there was some, there's a starting point of doing serious research about it. Before that, we were looking at epidemiological data, thinking about ideas, and the world is still trying to look for answer. Of course, the Americans spend a lot of time looking for drugs, but I think the answer is not in the drugs. That's what I think. What I'm going to do is to first introduce a collaboration. As you can see, there are many names there, but essentially, there are, you can see three parties. So I was telling for you that she said, hey, Prof, the slides are not quite right. There's a colorful logo. I said, never mind. Never change horses in midstream. You drown, you see. So apologies that it's not in color. So you have NUS, NUHS, NUH as one conglomerate. And then, of course, you have Prof Khor, Mr. Wisinto, Professor Rathi, Dr. Irish Rutter, and of course, Mr. Steele. I'm a special Mr. Steele as a silent head there. And then the second group, of course, the People's Association, the people. And of course, we are very fortunate to have Mr. Thomas Lee, Mr. Desmond Tan, Josephine Goh, Isabel Ho. These are the administrators that really, really wonderful people. Without them, this program can never go. And of course, I must also mention Mr. and Mrs. Gopal Kalapati. And I, in fact, persuaded Mr. Gopal Kalapati to say a few words after. I'm happy he said yes. Of course, I got Mrs. Maggie Sims somewhere. So these two are the chair of the active aging committees in the respective CCs, Queenstown for Mr. Gopal Kalapati, and in Eudos, I got Mrs. Maggie Sim, and the whole gang of people that they represent. And third, of course, is the National Park. I think the National Park is a very important partner because we know that this gardening is a therapeutic activity way back in the 1600s. I think the sort of Western countries realized the sanatorial effect of gardening. And of course, we got Dr. Roger Ho will tell you more about this. Suffice to say, we got Mr. Baxter, who actually worked very hard, and of course Hong Chong Yi, Chai Wei Li, Angelia Sia, Sibyl Ko. These are the people that we tango a lot from the National Park. So you can see a big gang, and we get along pretty well. Now, this program actually has got three major limbs. First is the idea of building capacity to self-education. At the end of it, we can only move if we know where we're moving to, right? So therefore, we spend a lot of energy to train the public, and train our volunteers. Okay. Second is this idea of prevention. Prevention is always better than cure, and dementia is no different, right? And we know that the genesis of dementia has got a lot to do with depression. So you better get rid of depression first, right? Of course, then this idea of translation research. Now, many people balk at the idea of translation research. They say, hey, guinea pig. No, it's not guinea pig. We just have to count numbers. People who participate and don't participate, does it make a difference? No? So no danger of being guinea pigs. So if you and your friends are pushed to join this program, it's not experiment. It's trying to see how we do things better. Okay, so with that, I better quickly go on. So this is an important slide. Why you implement this DPP? Well, essentially, we know that intensive lifestyle change and disease, high-risk disease control are proven. No doubt about it. But we think there are actually two other limbs. Okay, there's also this social connection and productive activities. Doing things are meaningful. That's productive activities. So what Mr. Gopal and Mrs. Gopal are doing, that's productive activities. Of course, there is this cognitive development, getting people to do things like photography, tai chi, qigong. Those are cognitive development activities. So put them together, you have a set of four things that will guarantee to get you out of dementia and live long and live well, believe you me. And if you want to read about research, there are lots in the Lancet, as Prof. Khor said. Okay, so that is therefore the whole basic concept. Now, this slide is complex. People tell me it's very complex, but it's very important. And I want you to pay attention to the right side. You see conditions that you're familiar with, right? People die of strokes, people get disabled by strokes, heart attack, the same thing. And then people have gangrene in the leg, peripheral artery disease, kidney failure, eyesight failure, and dementia, right? And then the latest member on board is this non-alcoholic fatty liver. Okay, so there are eight things there. Let's say, well, how do I remember eight things? Very simple. Three big vessels, three small vessels, and two special ones. The first three are the three big vessel problem. If you don't take care of your health properly, your three big vessels going to go will be the brain, the heart, and the legs. So three big vessels. The three small vessels are the eye, the kidney, and the nerve. Right? So you've got six with it, right? Dementia, there are two types of dementia, vascular dementia and Alzheimer's disease. Vascular dementia is due to people who have got high blood pressure. The poor vessel cannot tahan your high pressure. Of course, you slowly, slowly become calcified and narrowed. And non-alcoholic fatty liver is that the excess carbohydrate starch that you take that is not eaten is converted to fat. And where does it stay? In your good old liver and in your tummy. That's why people walk around with a big paunch. If you scan their liver, they got fatty liver. So what I'm going to do about that? Well, you can look a bit to your left, the high-risk diseases, the four. We call the deadly quartet. And the chief of the deadly quartet is obesity. In other words, many of our problems come from obesity. Then why so? It's a natural order of things. In the years gone by, when people are poor, they got no food. So they hunt for food. And where they have food is feast. No food is famine, right? So those are order of the day. So the desire of people of the day would be, say, if we can eat every day, wouldn't it be so good? And that's what is happening today. We are able to eat every day, right? Not like in the past. But the body has not changed. The body has that thrifty gene. It still prepares you for feast and famine. But today there's no famine, but every day is feast. So you go fatter and fatter. Right? That's one key idea. The second key idea is that we all like to be carried. Right? If you look at the movies, you look at the emperor in Rome, he's carried on a sedan chair. The emperor in China is carried on a sedan chair. To be carried is a great thing. And we want to have that. We don't want to walk. To walk is cheapskate. Why? That will explain why we don't have activity. So put together, these are the two reasons why people are getting fatter and fatter. The cultural DNA has not changed. The physical events have changed. Right? So we need to remember, culturally, we are still back there. We got to make corrections. We got to eat less. We got to exercise more. Okay? And of course, be to the left side, right? The left side, there are four things of importance. Talk about physical activity, talk about diet. Atherogenic diet is a calorie-rich diet, cholesterol-rich diet. And I add two more, smoking and alcohol overuse. I think in our country, alcohol is okay. I don't think we binge a lot. The word binge is very important. Alcohol, you take a bit of time, it's okay. If you take six bottles on the weekend and zero on the weekdays, that's worse than taking one bottle every day. Binge is the terrible thing to have. Cigarette smoking, of course, is a killer. There's no doubt about it. So the answer to live long and live well is on the right side. No? You pay attention to these four lifestyle things. If you are down with disease, pay attention to that. Then you can say the goodbye to the right side. Is that easy? That's all, no? Then you can live long, live well. So it's not rocket science, actually. Okay, so I spent a bit of time here, but I think it's very important to understand this concept. Once you understand this, the rest is easy. You don't have to see a doctor. Okay, this is just to sort of translate a bit about what has been presented by Prof. Rathi. So they started off the project with people choosing the activity. So you can choose bifidus, music, rabbit therapy, MRT, the Tai Chi is TCE. You can choose MAP, which is bifidus awareness, and you can of course choose art therapy. As you can see, whichever activity you choose, there is an improvement week 4 and then week 10. So there's a depression score, a self-score. Then if you look at anxiety, even better. But interesting, I was just looking at the slides last time. People who choose art therapy, because here they can choose, right? So people who choose art therapy are the purple people. Right? So they find that the anxiety score come down. So art therapy is not bad. What about the blue fellas? So the music and reminiscence, you've got to be quite steady before you can think about that. So initially, when people can choose, the people that choose music, reminiscence are people who are not anxious. From what you can see from this slide. So you find that the change is not great, right? The first blue, first bar, the first bar here. But for the rest, there is some improvement over time. Okay, so in other words, all these activities does help you in terms of anxiety, and we saw depression as well. Okay, so this is the program that we decided to put together after the results of the initial research, the idea of translation into the community. As you can see, there are four things, right? Health education as a base, the barrier flapping, which is actually very useful, and then gardening, I said just now, and this mindfulness awareness, and we have Mr. Wisinto to be the poster person here, right? And then music reminiscence. So these are the five pieces that we say everybody must have in order to be all right. Okay, so for education, we found that, cut to the chase, there are only about 10 topics that are important. The first four, you can identify, this is a deadly quartet, right? Your lifestyle, your blood pressure, diabetes, eating, and then in old people must prevent falls. If you don't prevent falls, then the life can be extinguished in a matter of minutes. All you need is a big fall in the toilet, and that's it, finish. And of course, we in order to get people to remember things, say, hello, there's a revision, give you MCQs to do. So this is the health, the physical health. Then the mental health, essentially, the idea of good mental health, anxiety, depression, dementia, must talk about it too, right? Then stress, insomnia. So these are the key things that we need to know as men in the street. Okay, so we are going to teach people all this so that it becomes second nature. Then Prof. Khor says, hello, Goh Lee Gan, you must not be too ambitious. The attention span of the old person is about 2 hours. So I bow to a psychiatrist. So we designed a program that's about 2 hours. And we did it, we do many things. Barrier flapping, health education, mindfulness, music and medicine, gardening. So actually we have 2 classes, Chinese and English, and then we rotate. And in the whole morning, we will do all this. I think gardening takes a longer time, right? Okay, then we say, okay, that's only conceptualization. How do you move the idea from the bench to the community? And that is very difficult. And I actually had great anxiety that we will ever even succeed. I was telling Mr. Steele, I said, I sat down there and I thought about the first session to meet all the people. I said, how to succeed? Now, how do I get people to buy the idea to start off with? But thankfully, we did succeed. That's why we are here. So we have 4 things. First, identify volunteers, participants, then we must set requirements for trainers, and then think of program support, administrative support, right? You must think of funding. Yes? I think funding is always important in any human activity, to be honest. Okay, so we say, okay, why don't we have an idea of sustainability? So for each CC, have 2 or 3 core volunteers, core trainers, so that these people are the ones that are master trainers in that CC, you see. And of course, there were local trainers that will come and go. And then participants, we talk about 50 people. And we said, okay, 65 to 74. It's actually kind of a very arbitrary number. We thought 65 would be the age that they are not too old, but not too young. Just take a long time to be demented, So we therefore chose 65. I was telling the reporters, I saw maybe if we got a bad wave, we'll choose 60. Work for people who are still okay. And of course, both the volunteers and participants must sign up with the idea that must come every week for 3 months. And after that, monthly for the whole year. So it's a lot of commitment, no? It's a commitment for all of us too, right? So that was the thing. And we said, okay, for the trainers, master trainers, must put them to training, serious training, 5 days. Then after that, they must train the local volunteers 5 to 10 sessions. So that was an act that we agreed, and we got all the volunteers to agree before they come in. And Mr. Gopal and his gang is the first social experimental persons that we use, okay? So we then say, okay, for the trainers, teach them in NUS. So we have these 5 mornings where we taught them things and teach them how to run group therapy sessions and whatnot. Popcorn was doing that. Then, okay, then they go and train the local trainers. So while they're training, we sit and watch. And then give them tips on how to train. Actually quite useful, quite important. If you want to do a translation research, must pay a lot of attention to this. You have to train people so that the program can sustain. No way we can sustain it by ourselves. And of course, we set all sorts of conditions. Mr. Wee is very good. He's very methodological. You watch and say, hey, Goh Lee Gan, we must introduce this and that. So we are now fairly tight on the requirements for people who want to do the 5 parts of the program. It's a lot of words. I think I will just pass by. Okay. Then, of course, you need program support, right? So program support, administration. You need to get people to come, when to come, where to go, and something. And you need the venue support, the classrooms, then this gardening area. Hey, there's gardening activity. You need to store all your tools and stuff. And of course, you need logistics. Tables and chairs, or board and table and chairs. This is what we need too. We need a defined place to store all your things, as to have a place that the plants can grow and not be disturbed. So it's a big undertaking. And I must thank Mr. Gopal Kanapati and his missus and Mrs. Maggie Sim. Actually, they took charge of all this sort of thing. So really, must thank them a lot. Okay, that's for funding. Funding is always an issue. When I talk about money, they say, wow, 25,000, cannot. If cannot, then cannot do law, right? So we really go to go and talk to various people. I think PA has been quite good supporters in that. I must thank Thomas for the hard work trying to sort of corner the money to get this project going. And then, of course, we have this 3 CCs that started off. Well, I've got 5 minutes left. Okay, so we actually had Queenstown, Eunos, and Tampines. And at this point, I want to call Mr. Gopal. Actually, it's called Active Aging Committee. So apologies. I thought it's called Wellness. Okay, Mr. Gopal, can I get you to say a few minutes of how do you see it from your perspective? I mean, this band of people at university to say, look, can you do something? Okay, the floor is yours.
Honourable Chairman, Associate Professor Mr. Goh Lee Gan, Guest of Honour Dr. Amy Khor, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I am greatly honoured to be standing before you to share my experiences in the dementia prevention journey in Queenstown. As an active ageing committee chairman in Queenstown constituency, I always believe in community partnership to bring innovative and meaningful programs for our seniors, and I'm glad that DPP is piloting in Queenstown. The objectives of DPP were aligned with PA Wellness Program that aims to engage our seniors physically, mentally, and socially in taking charge of their health and leading a better quality of life. This is a volunteer-driven program as the grassroots organization at Queenstown started by creating awareness in the community and through platforms such as health and dementia talks. It was not an easy task for me and my community initially. However, at this point, I'd like to mention, if it's not for the encouraging and motivating inspiration by one person, that is Mrs. Teo Chee Hien, if it's not for her, I wouldn't have taken this challenge. She says, you go ahead, we are best behind you to support for this program. And that gave me the willingness to proceed. Maybe again for her impression. And, however, with the strong grassroots support and the expertise from NUHS, we are able to encourage our seniors to volunteer with, and from there, we went on to recruit more participants for the program. All in all, we managed to recruit close to 20 volunteers and 40 over participants. We wanted the volunteers and the participants to be comfortable in the language they preferred. So we divided them into two groups, one in Mandarin and one in English. Through this program, senior volunteerism was greatly amplified. The pilot program at Queenstown was a success, greatly because of the group of passionate and warm-hearted volunteers that we have. It is essential to touch and hold our seniors. Therefore, capability building of our volunteers is vital in paving the success for the program. With the help of NUHS and NPARC, the trainers framework was set up, and these active seniors were trained and empowered as trainer to conduct activities as part of lifelong learning, helping fellow seniors to delay the onset of dementia. The volunteers have to go through hours of lessons to enhance their knowledge and capability in order to be trainers to teach fellow participants. It was a steep learning curve, but most of our volunteers enjoyed themselves and shared that they feel better as they understand dementia more and are less afraid of it. Age is just a number to them. Their learning attitude towards picking up new skills and gaining knowledge is positive, and that impressed me. Let me share with you an example. I have a volunteer who had never done meridian flapping before. She was unsure if she can take up the trainer's role for that, but she took it up and persevered on with the guidance from the experts. Now she's able to lead the group with confidence in the community interest group. I would also like to share that seniors in Queenstown community understand more about dementia now as word of mouth spreads. Our participants in the program are like our ambassadors. They are sharing the knowledge gained in the program with their friends and family. They took the classes seriously and did their own homework to share more with their peers as well. One participant even volunteered to assist the trainer to prepare both English and Mandarin lyrics to share in the music remnants class so that everyone can sing together. This program has developed the community bonding among our seniors, which is also what we aim for when we decided to take up this program in Queenstown. After the 12 weeks of program, strong social connectedness was established among the seniors as the trainers and participants became friends, encouraging one another to stay alive, to stay active and sharp. We have also provided platforms such as community activities and interest groups, which further deepen our engagement with them. Today, this group of seniors are strongly knitted and keen to learn more. They even requested to have more TPP sessions. I'm glad to be a part of this program and to be here sharing my experience with you. Thank you, and thank to the organization for giving an opportunity to express my experience with them, our community, our Queenstown community DPP program. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Gopal, for that sharing. Okay, I'm going to wrap up in 1 minute. This was a profile. You know, so we had two centers, about 50 people each, fairly elderly people too. And of course, we did not forget about graduation ceremonies. This is very important. And this is to show you the early results, 3 months. Of course, it's a very small study, 18 out of 37. So certainly, by statistical tests, you say, hello, that's so small, suburb. But nevertheless, we did see that baseline depression rate did go down, right? And then we also see that anxiety also come down, social connectedness go up, and also life satisfaction go up. So I think we're on the right track. But most important of all, we did were doing right because there were very few dropouts. I think the first test whether your community program is alive or dead is that how many dropouts have you got? People vote with their feet. If it's not interesting, they won't come the next time. So I think we are all right. Okay, so going on from there then is this idea of going from strength to strength. I think we probably have made the right way to prevent dementia. Time will tell, but I'm sure we're on the right track. So with that note, let me thank you for your attention. I know, sorry, we eaten up some time, but we'll catch up. Thank you.
So you see that this research is called a translational research, and it's the holy grail of research. Often we do research in the laboratory, and then it finishes off, you know. But this is something of relevant to people's life. That's what the scientists want to do. Whatever we do can be translated, and it's taken about 12 years. Now, I want to clarify a point. It doesn't mean that everybody who goes through the program will be cured or prevented from having dementia. In the initial assessment, I thought that maybe 10%. 10% is about 2,000 cases, and it's safe, you know. My Harvard friend who came down, went to the program with us, and said, there's possibly even 20%. So we are quite sanguine that things will move well. And you see that it takes a lot of people's time to get it done and trickle down to the grassroots level, you know. And I remember a couple of sessions I had with Mrs. Steele and Professor Goh Lee Gan was to find out what kind of slides to put up, you know. Sometimes we have slides that are too crowded, you know, and too much scientific data that people, the grassroots, may not want to read that kind of thing. So what kind of slides to put up, how to teach them, we train them, skills on group therapy, very important. And you realize that we thought initially it was just for dementia, depression, but the important part of it was the social connectedness. They began to know each other better. The Jurong side, they're all living alone. They don't know who is down their corridor. Now they're coming together. The young elderly begin to help the old elderly. It's something wonderful for the community. And one of the reasons why we think this important program is because it first has to be structured, you know. And secondly, it has to be something that is evidence-based. And thirdly, it has to be something that has to be evaluated. So someone told me, can I take this program? And we don't want evaluation. Okay, evaluation assessment is something frightening to all of us. Since the days of PSLE, people are frightened of assessment. So why should you evaluate them? So we think that it's important to evaluate so that we know what's gone wrong and how to improve on it. So another area of evaluation, of assessment, and also evidence-based is every time there's a program up, we tell them, okay, you do mindfulness practice. They say, where's the evidence? There you are. Professor Mahendran showed you the brain pictures of changes. And then the issue of other modalities. Next one, Professor Roger Ho will speak on the research on NPARKS. You know, this is a very important study because now people are very keen on gardening since we won the UNESCO prize. Quite a number from NPARKS here. But I think even if you don't win the prize, there's so much things for you to enjoy in the garden. You know. So Professor Roger Ho, shall we welcome him?
Good morning, everyone. I represent Professor Goh Lee Gan, the organizing chair, Mr. Lawrence Wee, the president, for organizing this conference. I'm very fortunate to present my funding to and my project to guest of honor, Dr. Amy Goh and also Mrs. Teo Po Yim. I'm Dr. Roger Ho, a consultant psychiatrist and associate professor from Department of Psychological Medicine, NUS. Let me tell you about my background. I am actually not a biological scientist, not a plant biologist, I'm a psychiatrist. So without the support of my colleagues and the empire, I think this project would not be successful. So I have to thank Professor Khor. I mean, he's a mentor for me for the past 14 years, and he introduced me to this project. And it's also a very different perspective, because as a medical doctor and also academic, first of all, myself, most of the time actually I stay in the office. My office don't have window, so cannot even perform photosynthesis. The other thing is, we, as a doctor, we prescribe medications. So today I'm talking about using gardening, or what we call the horticultural therapy, to help patients. So it's very different from prescription of medications. I think the third thing is that as a scientist, as a clinician scientist, our research in the past mainly focused on molecules, for example, or biomarker. But now we work with NUS and National Park to translate our research into meaningful program to help elderly in Singapore. So I also thank Professor Rathi, Professor Tang Jae Hoon, Dr. Iris Rottier, who also helped me in this project, Dr. Fong Lei. And very important is our colleagues from National Park, because that with the expertise, Meso is actually one of the horticultural therapists, and he actually have guided our elderly, and Julia Sash is here today, Kenneth Koo and Sipo Ko. So that without their help, this project would not be successful. And we also work with A-Star, Dr. Annelise, Crystal Tan, and one of the very important person is my PhD student, Mr. Ng Keng Shang. He's actually working very hard in the lab, and he's actually analyzing the results at this moment. Okay, so the background of the horticultural therapy, the definitions. This intervention is mediated by the nature. Okay, so what is horticultural therapy? So it is interventions that is nature-oriented, and we based on open spaces, garden, and gardening work. Just follow up what Professor Goh Lee Gan just mentioned. The horticultural therapy was invented more than 2 years ago. In fact, if you go back to the history of psychiatry in the 19th century, there's an American called Dr. Benjamin Rush. He's actually signed the Declaration of Independence. And he was a psychiatrist. He was called the father of American psychiatry. 200 years ago, he already observed that psychiatry patients benefit from gardening. But nowadays, it's not just focused on patients, it's focused on even healthy individuals. So the value is the open view, closest to nature, and it's very important to our survival. So how does it work for Singaporean? So we live in a city state, so we are being away from the urban area. So the environment, the park, will absorb the persons, and it's also allowed the plants and human interactions. So this stimulation garden will encourage attention and concentrations. So the psychological basis of horticultural therapy. One of the key thing is the attentions. Of course, if today you're attending the talk, you also pay attention to the speaker. But we actually want the attention is what we call the involuntary attention. So you don't need to really force yourself, but you go to the park, you become involuntary, you pay attention to the scene, to the sound of the nature. So this is very important. In fact, there is an association called the American Horticultural Therapy Associations, and they define the criteria for successful horticultural therapy, and the environment actually must promote involuntary attentions. And so the human adopt to the natural environment, and then it will help them to have a preference, develop a preference for trees and flowers, and also reduce stress. The next slide, the biological basis. Yeah, the biological basis of horticultural therapy. P Previous research have found that it will help to improve or reduce the high blood pressure, reduce the heart rate, and reduce some of the stress hormones. So this was found in other study. Of course, in our study, I think Mr. King Shang is still working very hard to actually we have measured some of the more novel biological marker. So in the near future, we will have the result. Okay, next slide. Benefit of horticultural therapy. So as I mentioned, it will lead to positive change in mood, anxiety, and well-being. You may ask why we actually offer this to elderly. Besides improving the mood, we also believe in the cognitive aspect. Definitely, in some of the activities, the elderly may use their problem-solving techniques when they have to grow plants. And the plant growing will give the participants satisfaction and hope. You may also ask what happened is the plant growing not successful. So we also hope to develop the resilience in the elderly. Even if it's not successful, they will try it again. So we hope that after the program, they will continue or bring the skill back to their home and what they learned in the therapy sessions. So our session actually adapt to individual ability, especially our elderly to perform the activity. Later on, you will see that we have carefully designed a program, so it's not too long. We also have some indoor activity due to sometimes like the weather changes. As I mentioned before, this therapy is free from side effect. It's different from some of our medications. And very relevant to Singapore because our government have built a lot of beautiful park in the city and people can visit the park at any time when they're convenient. Next slide. Quality of the garden for horticultural therapy. So the American Horticultural Therapy Association have defined some of the criteria. So the garden have to be attractive so that it will increase the urge for people and plants interactions. So they also must have a variety of plants, material that attract birds and butterflies, and reflect the sky, and provide a home for the fish, and it's open to all of us, our senses, visuals, hearing, maybe smell, so that the participant will be stimulated. And it attracts people from all classes. I think I personally had to benefit a lot from this program when I followed the participant to a different park, so give me a break from my research office. So it's really a positive experience. Next slide, the evidence of horticultural therapy. As I mentioned before, the United States actually started this almost 200 years ago. In one of the recent study, interestingly, they could not find any differences between the group on the domain or mood. But other countries in Asia, for example, Hong Kong, actually have found that the horticultural therapy have reduction on depression, anxiety, and stress in the psychiatry patients. In another study, they found there's improvement. In Hong Kong, they found that there's improvement in life satisfaction and social networking. In Korea, in stroke patients, they found that stroke survivors receiving horticultural therapy, they have increased their self-esteem and they become empowered. I think the other concept about horticultural therapy is these are enabling garden to actually enable, empower the participants so that they feel more confidence, they improve their self-esteem. Okay, our NUS research project. We have completed our project. I think we are analyzing the result. We hope to share the result with all of you in the near future, but today we would like to share with you our methodology. So the hypothesis, I think this is a research project, as Prof. Khor mentions, we must actually also show the evidence that this therapy works. So we as researchers, so before we start our project, we have a few hypotheses. So we have two groups, we randomize them, as in other research conducted by like Prof. Rathi. So we have one group randomized to the weight control, one group randomized to the horticultural therapy by our computer program. So we hypothesize that those who participate in the horticultural therapy compared to the weight control. The weight control, what do they mean is that they will wait for a while. To be fair to them, eventually they will receive the horticultural therapy, but they have to wait for like 6 months or so while the intervention group go through the therapy, but we assess both group. But the weight control, at the end, they will still get the therapy. So we hypothesize the active therapy group will have a lower depression and anxiety score after the therapy, higher life satisfactions, feel more socially connected, and the improvement in cognitive functioning. the effect of horticultural therapy on our Asian elderly. So the study design, as I mentioned, is a randomized controlled trial. We start with the Jurong area, so we recruit around 69 elderly. This is a pilot study. So of course, we can expand the sample size in the future. So the participant will initially go for weekly horticultural therapy. There's a three-month assessment. Later on, we will change to monthly and a six-month assessment. So the assessment to verify or prove our hypothesis, including the assessment of cognitive functioning, the life satisfaction, psychological well-being, social connections, depression, anxiety, symptomology, and some of the blood pressure and pulse rate. All these measures were actually assessed by questionnaires by our trained research assistants. This is the weekly program. One of the criteria for successful horticultural therapy is must be structured and well-designed. So, with the collaboration of National Park, our participants will actually go to different park, and there will be volunteers and trained horticultural therapists to guide the participant. So in the beginning, we have indoor activities so that the participant will understand each other with introductions, and we have growing veggie growing, and you may ask for an interpretive walk. Again, this is a guided tour in some of our garden and natural reserve, press the flowers and compost making. We harvest the vegetable and then we'll be cooking, and also at the end we have a kosher for our horticultural therapy. So these are some of the photos taken during the some of the sessions, which is indoor gardening. We sometimes use it when it rains. So as you can see that they're also quite enjoyable in the indoor environment. And another criteria for successful horticultural therapy is must be safe. So if, let's say it's raining, it's sleepy, so we may actually convert into indoor. Pressed flowers. This is a photo taken after the park visit. And this is gardening. In the Chinese garden in Jurong, there's an area we actually, for the elderly, so they will grow the plant and they will visit the plant to see the outcome after a few weeks. It's a guided tour with our volunteer and also colleagues from National Park. There will be a monthly program. Again, there will be an interpretive walk. A lot of elderly are actually very interested how to maintain a garden. And also, they also want to find out, you know, the herbs, because they're very interested about herbs. So our National Park colleagues also give talk to guide them. So the significance of this study, we're looking forward to share with you the result in the near future. But again, this is a very good treatment especially for lawn patients, because it's a lawn jog approach. It's a popular leisure activity, and it's sustainable, and it also involves our community volunteers, and using our existing resources, i.e. the public parks. Okay, so thank you very much for listening to my talk. Later on, I'm happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Professor Ho. The results are actually out. It's being embargoed because the Minister of State, Mr. Desmond Lee, will want to present the results next week in opening of the therapeutic park at Hort Park. So we're not supposed to tell anyone. You see that the dementia prevention program is to build up mental resilience for the elderly people, for the prevention of depression and dementia. But in the process of it, as you listen to Professor Goh Lee Gan, it's also to maintain, to stabilize their hypertension and diabetes. So you also tackle four diseases now: depression, dementia, hypertension, and diabetes. And so it's mental resilience, but also realize that developing this program over 12 years, the researchers must also have mental resilience. And often that you become very dismayed, you become disillusioned, and you want to give up the whole project. So it is what it is. If you are keen on doing translational research, it's a long and winding road. And so the next person who's going to speak to us is on something which Professor Mahendran mentioned earlier on the brain imaging.
Some people told us that, well, pencil and paper, our elderly people may not be giving the right results, but we want evidence-based, you know, the hard facts, you know, the truth is in the images. You know. So we've asked Professor Johnson Pham to come and give a talk now. I hope it's working now, right? Okay, Professor Johnson Pham is an assistant professor in our department and very keen on brain imaging. I hope she'll explain it in a very simple way. It can be very complicating on the changes in the study on mindfulness. Shall we welcome Professor Johnson Pham?
Okay, good morning, everyone. Good to be here. Good to see everybody pretty much still awake. So I'm going to talk about brain imaging. We're going to switch gears a bit to delve a little bit into science of what we do as an intervention for people with a mild cognitive impairment. So in the 1800s, how do you image the brain? Pretty much with your eye and a pencil. And you basically have to image the brain post-mortem, as in the person dies, you open up the brain and you sketch the brain. And this is what you see. So an artistic person will draw what they see, and this will be in textbooks for people, in papers for people to see what they see in the post-mortem studies. So fast forward two centuries, so what do we have today? So we have more sophisticated imaging, as in we can look directly into a person's brain while they are still living. And they have CT scans, they have MRI scans, and these scans can be performed very readily without any pain or discomfort. Okay, basically a person, why is it? Okay, so a patient basically just lies on the bed, resting, and it's skipping. So a person lies inside, and the scan is performed, and you can see the image in real time, meaning the scan is done, and you see it almost immediately. And with more advanced techniques, you can now basically see the brain in very fine slices. You can see slices of the brain from top to bottom, left to right, front to back, and you can just pick and choose which slice of the brain you want to see. Besides looking at the brain itself, you can even peel down the layers of the brain, and you look at the individual fibers of the brain. So these It's gone again. Glitchy. If you imagine the brain is somewhere here. So is it coming back on? Okay, so this is your brain. And you can actually image with diffusion-weighted imaging, you can actually see the individual fiber tracks of the brain. So if you look at the just one portion of the brain, you see that it is a very fine weave of fiber tracks. Okay, so each fiber track will run all over the brain. It runs in almost every other direction, and one track is made up of many neurons. Neurons are the basic cells in the brain that convey information from one point to another. Okay, so how do these tracks work? So I'll take you back to an analogy. This is the MRT system from the 1990s. So things were simple then. You had the north-south line, and you have the east-west line. So there are trains, there are train stations, and there are intersections. Okay. So they serve regions, east-west, north-south, the individual stations where the trains stop, and there were in the past very few intersections. Basically, City Hall and Raffles Place are where the north, south, and east-west meet, and you can change and hop over to the other train. So today, things are more complicated. There are more stations, there are more lines, and there are more intersections. You can change trains at many intersections running in different directions. So this is the MRT system we have today in Singapore. And in the future, it might look like this. This is the Tokyo railway system, one of the most complicated in the world. You'd be hard-pressed to to find where you're going unless you really look into it. So, but despite the complexity of things, basic principles remain the same. There are train lines, there are stations, and there are intersections. So whether it's simple or complicated, these basic system structures are in place, okay? And similarly, in our brain is made up of an estimated of 3 billion neurons. And if you can imagine, the brain cannot possibly fire all neurons at the same time. Otherwise, there'll be chaos, right? So trains they run one at a time in sequence and in time. Same way our brain fires in a logical manner. So although there are many, many connections in the brain that you see, at any one point in time, a relay of a message, as you see in the green streak, it only runs that brief moment in time. So neurons that fire together, they tend to wire together. The more frequently the neurons fire, the more the connection is strengthened. So we look at the brain activation. So is this back on a more macro scale. We see that the brain actually works in a coordinated manner. You see the dots, these red dots on the brain. So these are the areas that, for example, if you are focusing on a particular task, certain regions of the brain will tend to be activated together. And if you look at another form of a study looking at anti-correlations, there are certain parts of the brain that are not meant to fire when the brain is doing something. So the brain will do something in coordination with other parts of the brain altogether, and there are parts of the brain that are not meant to work while certain brain areas are being functional. Okay, so areas will function, areas will not function. And we look at, this is part of what the subsequent analysis is going to be. So I will just describe a bit what happens. So we know what areas of the brain are activated or not activated. We know the fiber track system of the brain. And here we can analyze during a particular situation how the brain works. So you can see these big red dots are like your train stations. Okay, the more connections there are to this station, the bigger the red dot. Okay, and also the fiber track. So thin fiber tracks are less well traveled, and thick fiber tracks means heavy traffic. So there are areas of the brain where there are more connections, and there are tracks in the brain that see higher traffic. All right, and we can arrange the track system in the brain into regions. These little dot, each dot you see is a node. And a collection of nodes, you have a submodule. And you, a collection of submodules, you have modules. Okay, so this is how you arrive at modular architecture in the brain, which is what we'll do in our study later. So what we did in our study, using a mindfulness practice, was that we had patients with a mild cognitive impairment enrolled in this program. So people with mild cognitive impairment are basically people with no dementia. They have a subjective memory complaint, and they have at least a single domain deficit on a cognitive assessment using a formal scale. Okay, so we had this group of patients with mild cognitive impairment, or MCI. They enrolled in this mindfulness practice program, which had two arms to it. So one arm received the active intervention, which was the mindfulness awareness practice. The other group was randomized into a healthy health education program, which consisted of health talks. So they were randomized into two groups. So eventually, we had about 20 plus per group at the beginning, and some dropouts later, about 17 and 19, about 3 months later from the start of the program. So talk about the control group first. So the control group attended health education talks. They listened to a talk held once a week at the Tara Center in Jurong. And each session covered a different topic. For example, common ailments like hypertension, diabetes. Session could talk about how to increase your physical activity and exercise, or how to eat healthily with a healthy diet. Okay, so these people went for weekly health talks. So the intervention group went for mindfulness awareness practice. So as John Kabat-Zinn nicely capsuled, it just in gist means that you need to pay attention in a particular way, on purpose, in the present moment, using a non-judgmental manner. So these people went through mindfulness exercises, and they were asked to practice these exercises at home. Same thing, the frequency was once every week for a total period of 3 months. And let's look at the some demographic data of our group. So on average, our patients were aged around 70. There was not much difference in terms of age at baseline. Gender, there were more females than males, but again, there was no statistical difference between the two groups. Race, mainly Chinese, one Indian. Education, about this the number of years of education, between 3 to 4 years of education. So what's more important is the baseline. This is the mini mental state examination, which is the cognitive screen that is used for common screening for dementia. So on baseline, they were around 24. Maximum score is 30. So not the best, but just to show that at baseline, both groups were about similar. Okay, these were the specific cognitive tests that we did that delved deeper into a cognitive function. The this is a delayed recall test, this is a recognition test, and this is a block design test. And as you can see, there were some changes over time. So this is baseline, two groups. This is on follow-up, and these are the two groups. Okay, so at baseline for the delayed recall, there was a between-group difference. The MAP did worse off than the HEP group, meaning the mindful group was worse off than the health education group. But at follow-up, there was still this change between groups, but also within group. Okay, as you can see, there was improvement from 7.5 to about 8, from time point 1 to time point 2, but there was also improvement in the mindfulness group between time point 1 and time point 2. Okay, and the difference between the follow-up and the baseline was greater in the mindfulness group. Now look at the next task, recognition. There was a within group change only in the mindful practice group. So there was an improvement in the mindful awareness practice group in this cognitive test, but for the health education, there was no statistically significant improvement. Next is the block design. Again, you see for the mindfulness group, time point 1, time point 2, there was an improvement, but for health education, between time point 1 and time point 2, there was no difference. So there were some cognitive gains to be had in the mindfulness practice group over time. And this was the brain analysis that we did. So as you remembered earlier, there were these tracks that the brain had at a resting state. And these were the nodes, like the train stations you have on the train system. So they can be organized into regions and modules using our data analysis, computerized data analysis. So each dot you see is a particular brain region, and these are the abbreviations for the brain regions. As you can see, there are many of them. and we look at what happened. So this is the modular architecture of the brain. This is at baseline. Okay, at baseline, you see that this is an aggregate of the baseline. So this is what you see for modules 1, 2, 3, 4 at baseline. So both are similar, whether you're in the health education group or mindfulness practice group, the baseline looks similar. But what happened on follow-up 3 months later was that there was not much change in the health education group. As you can see, these two, the profile of the modular architecture remained the same. But for the mindfulness practice group, there was a significant difference. Right, the region 4 was subsumed into region 3. Region 3 is an important area of memory and its associated cognitive function, which is the temporal lobe. So the greater the associated structures that is involves the temporal lobe means it's better for brain function related to memory. Okay, so what are these brain regions that kind of got more connected at the temporal module? So these are the ones. So remember the three cognitive tasks that we did? So these are the areas that were associated with the improvements in the cognitive scales. So as you can see, there are many permutations, but the permutations that were statistically significant with regards to the cognitive assessments were all related to module 3. So intermodular interaction between 1 and 3, between 2 and 3, between 3 and 4. The intermodular interaction between 1 and 2, 1 and 4, 2 and 4, these were not present. So all involved the temporal region of the brain that showed improvement. So associated improvements are with 1 and 3, recognition, 2 and 3 was with delayed recall, 3 and 4 was with recognition. And these are the nodal efficiencies of the brain regions. 6 brain regions exhibited these correlations with the cognitive improvements. And these were mainly found, these regions represented mostly the hippocampal and temporal regions of the brain. Okay. And we look at the local efficiency. So this is a measure of how efficient, for example, if you imagine how efficient a train system is, you can do the same with brain networks. How efficient is it in the brain? So we can see local efficiency of the brain network. There was not much of a difference at baseline between health education and mindfulness, but there was a statistically significant difference between the two groups at time point 2. And for the mindfulness, between time point 1 and time point 2, there was also a statistical difference. All right? Okay. So, in summary, mindfulness awareness practice for community-dwelling elders with mild cognitive impairment seems to suggest that it may improve brain function. Effects were noted after 3 months of weekly session. We were not sure whether the results did not seem as robust if follow up longer, but the larger study is needed. So longitudinal effects over a longer time period and a larger sample will be needed whether mindfulness practice could sustain these cognitive improvements over time. Okay, with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention.
So thank you, Dr. Pham. You may not know this, the first time he's presenting to all of us, the first study in the world on mindfulness practice in elderly people in the community. You know. And you realize that our team, we have people who are very senior, people who are young. Yeah. So if you have, even in the community program where you come from, make sure there's a good mix. We also have Dr. Emily Ho, a team, Dr. Chris Soy and Iris, so there's a continuity in what we are doing. So now is question time. Any question for any of the speakers here? The last the last talk was all, I've heard many of talks on brain imaging. Sometimes it is very confusing, very convoluted, but this is done in by Dr. Pham with scintillating clarity. It's easier to understand. You know.
Maybe I start the ball rolling.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, let me ask Dr. Pham. I mean, all this looks very fascinating. How do you come to grips with such a complex structure as a brain to sort of organize it into stations and nodes and tracks?
The technique is actually with graph theory analysis. They actually use this method wasn't originally applied to brain imaging, but we see that it is a sensible way to look at a complicated organ such as the brain. So they used to use this method to study, for example, the example of your train, railway systems, shipping lines, and even air traffic. So I think this can be similarly applied to the human brain, which is far more complex.
So I was going to ask Dr. Ho, sort of looking at this horticultural therapy, a bit of how do you link the present with the past?
The 200 years ago when they started this horticultural therapy, of course, it's more based on observation, but I think nowadays people formalize the therapy. I think as in other therapy, like our cognitive behavioral therapy is also manualized, so there are criteria, like for, I think we share before is the park design, and it must be accessible, safe, and promote people and plants interactions. And of course, I think a lot of study have demonstrated the effects based on questionnaire. But now, I think our team is also measure some of the more novel biological marker in the blood of the participants. So to see how the horticultural therapy actually really benefit the person, maybe even at the cytokine or molecular level. So I think these are the new changes.
Okay, anybody else? Although Professor Goh mentioned there are two other centers in Eunos and Tampines, now I understand that Dr. Amy Khor want to introduce that in Hong Kah, down there is David and Arthur. They're starting one more at Toei area. You know, the Toei will be a bit different because we thought maybe we should not just focus on the elderly, it should be the whole family. You know, how the family looks after an old person and what kind of community support this will, can be provided. And this will be also a longitudinal study that goes over 10 years. And probably, once again, the first study in the world. You know, that's very important for Singapore and for the region itself. You know. But we also need new blood to come in to help us out. We hope there are volunteers. I know at the corner there is Dr. Tina Ong, some IMH. She's quite keen to join us and to come on board, you know, to part of this big team. Any other questions? Anyone?
You know, can I share some personal insights? Sure. Okay, I mean, one of the challenges as a doctor is that how do you get people to begin to exercise? Because we know that exercise does cause some amount of weight loss, although not very much actually. And then, of course, this idea of eating the right thing. Okay, so as I said in Clementi Polyclinic, with that kind of thought kind of rushed through my head time and time again. They say, oh, doctor, cannot lay. I had never exercised ever in my life. How do you expect me to start exercising now? So then I say, okay, maybe build into your life, maybe after lunch, after dinner, what about that? But I think the best result actually come from your own experimentation. Because I got two sisters-in-law, they all have diabetes. One is pre-diabetes, one is full-blown diabetes. And the common denominator is that they did not exercise. And also one of them was quite fat. So I said, okay, let me use this as social experimental animals. So the first thing I did was to say, okay, maybe I should try to start walking and see how it feels like to walk. So we used to walk in the stadium behind my house. And I dragged my wife along, I dragged my mother-in-law. So okay lah, you know, so we did keep up to maybe 4 or 5 times a week. You're supposed to exercise 5 times a week, 30 minutes each time. So we did manage to get on. Then one day my wife said, hey, this is all very boring. Hey, Goh Lee Gan, can you take me to Botanic Gardens? I said, okay. So kind of a bit curious what she sees in Botanic Gardens. And that was quite interesting. And so I was listening to Roger. I think you can never predict the value of walking in Botanic Gardens, because she says, every day she says, hey, so today we can walk or not? And I then extended the experiment to my brother-in-law, and that also caught on. And then my sister-in-law, and so today we got about four or five people trying to walk Botanic Gardens, and we never get tired of it. So my take-home message to you is that maybe you should try taking people to walk in Botanic Gardens if you want to get them to start walking. Of course, then what about eating? I also found for my students, I mean, we have this attachment and they're going to do some research. So one of my students said, hey, I'm interested in weight regain, because I noticed that when people try to lose weight, they succeed for 6 months, but the next 6 months, they put on all the weight that they lost. So, Prof, I like to do a review of the literature to see whether there's any answers. So I said, well, jolly good idea. So we went to search the literature, and we came up with some papers to talk about the idea of protein, the role of protein in weight loss control. And what we found is that people who increase their protein, see, we take about 1 gram of protein per day, and translated, it's actually the size of a pump for each meal. So in 3 days, we take the equivalent of 3 pumps of protein, be it animal protein, vegetable protein, including nuts, it's also protein, right? So, okay, so what we did was that we looked at literature, and the take-home message is if you half the carbohydrate and double the protein, you got it about right. And the Atkins diet, of course, they went to extreme, they take all protein but no carbohydrate, but cannot, the brain cannot survive on that kind of strict regimentation. We need some protein, we need some carbo, and we need more protein. Now, what is interesting is that the carbo that you take that is not used up is converted to fat. But the protein that you take that is not used up is actually excreted. Contrary to what I learned in my physiology lessons when I was a medical student, they say, oh, it's converted to fat too. Nonsense, it's not, it's just excreted. So therefore, encouraging people to take protein seems to be to have at least 3 positive things. Number one, it creates satiety. Number two, you're happy, and so you don't chase after food. And thirdly, of course, the desired effect of keeping your weight down. So maybe this is something that you also want to go experiment with yourself and your friends. Maybe these are some of the revelations we get sitting in the clinic trying to find answers for people.
So I think we have to round up this discussion. So you see, an idea was seeded 12 years ago. And it's taken us a long time, a long and winding road. We're able to ask people to join us on this bandwagon. And besides doctors, the other people, policy makers to help us out, we also have many research assistants, people like Fadzila, Hui Yi, Siu Yong, in the back was King Siang, many people involved. And all this is meant for the betterment of people's life here in Singapore. Somewhere in the audience is Mr. Chua Song Kim. Is he still around? Yeah, Song Kim is the previous CEO of NUH, and when NHG was formed, I told them that the mission statement should be adding years of healthy life to the people of Singapore. You know, then my friend said, "Oh, Dr. Kwai, I heard you're quite good as a wordsmith. This is nothing. This is very boring. You know, you want something stirring. You know," I said, "What's that's mostly one important thing, adding years of healthy life to the people of Singapore. You know, so people have." In terms of their life, in terms of the quality of life in Singapore. And no one was interested until a friend of mine came from Stanford, the professor of psychiatry, said, "This is the best mission statement I've seen in the world. You know, America is, we want to be number one, we want to make more money in all these hospitals, but it's adding years of healthy life to the people of Singapore, and this is what the program is all about." So thank you once again. Shall we thank all our speakers again? Professor Goh Lee Gan. Thank you. Thank you. Roger Ho.
last but not the least, Dr. Johnson Pham.